Hello, this is Joshua Shudell at Mechanical Simulation Corporation. In this video, we will be discussing high-performance computing, or HPC, solutions for vehicle simulation, in particular with the VehicleSim family of products, CarSim, TruckSim, BikeSim, and SuspensionSim. We will start with an overview of what HPC is, why it's useful, and whether or not it can help save time and or money for your organization. We'll then take a look at some example implementations of an HPC stack, and discuss how this architecture can be used in conjunction with VehicleSim and why your organization may find value in doing so. Finally, we'll go over a brief demo, running CarSim in a simplified DOE scenario wherein we perform a large number of simulations in a fraction of the time possible without HPC. First of all, what even is HPC and why should you be interested in it? HPC generally refers to one of two things. It may be used to describe a hardware scenario in which multiple computers are connected through some means in order to provide a single computing platform, usually called a cluster. This cluster draws upon the resources of all of the underlying hardware, and this aggregate computing platform is generally managed by some form of software which handles the resource allocation on your behalf, making interacting with it simple. Additionally, others refer to HPC as the act of running applications specifically targeted for these aggregated computing platforms. In this case, HPC refers to designing and delegating computationally expensive tasks to the cluster. Most of the time, this involves splitting the full workload into multiple smaller, non-interacting parts that can be performed in parallel and merged or reviewed once all the work has been completed. In this video, we will be mostly talking about the second definition of designing applications for an already existing HPC cluster. But why would anyone want to go through the effort of building this hardware and designing these specialized applications? Well, within the field of vehicular simulation, there are several good reasons. By combining our computing resources, we can also increase the resolution of our models while not sacrificing simulation speed. By allowing for multiple simulations to run simultaneously, tens, hundreds, or even thousands of solvers running in parallel, we can perform large-scale batches of runs in fractions of the time, even allowing long-running complex simulations to run while not blocking smaller, less complex simulations from completing. When working with DOE simulations, where parameters are modulated across runs, thousands or millions of permutations can be sent to the HPC cluster, an amount of runs that would be quite taxing and lengthy on a single system. This all sounds enticing, but are the time savings guaranteed? And surely something with such big promises must be expensive. Well, yes and no. In terms of time savings, there are several important factors that can determine your success. How your workload is defined. HPC is at its most useful when working with independent, non-interacting tasks. A workload comprised entirely out of simulations that depend on the result of previous simulations requiring serialization will see little benefit. Whereas large numbers of runs that can be run without regard to order can be completed quite quickly. How many executors or workers you have available? This means how many simulations can be executed in parallel. Completing millions of simulations will be much faster with 1,000 simultaneous workers than with only 10. With VehicleSim, this number is determined by the number of licenses you have available, something we will cover later in this video. Resource limits. Even if you have created 1,000 workers and have 1,000 licenses available, if your underlying cluster hardware can only support 50 workers, there is going to be a bottleneck in the virtualized hardware. Be sure to consider what limitations your hardware may impose on any maximums to your workload. Throughput. You can only process tasks as fast as you can get them into and out of your workers. Perhaps your HPC cluster is located geographically distant from you, or maybe your networking throughput isn't high enough, or you are limited by disk read-write speed. These two must be considered in terms of your maximum workload processing power. Most, if not all, of the above can be solved by increasing budget size, but what are the options available? The arguably most cost-effective is running your own HPC cluster on-site. Purchasing hardware that you personally host and manage can be a large upfront cost, but over time, the savings can be immense, especially if you are performing very complex simulations or if you have a deterministic workload where you do not anticipate needing to quickly expand your resources. Similar to running a local cluster, a remote private cluster effectively gives you singular access to a server. However, in this instance, all of the management is done by a third party, allowing your organization to focus on application development and not worry about cluster resource management. Depending on who this is purchased from, expanding resources in your cluster may be near instantaneous or could require time. Public remote clusters are one of the most common options due to their ease of use and ready availability. Household names like Amazon AWS, Microsoft Azure, and Google Cloud Platform dominate this space, although there are many others. These generally charge by resource utilization, only making you pay for the amount of resources you actually use. This ease of use comes at a cost, however, as you are now as far as possible away from the underlying hardware, meaning although you can add additional resources nearly instantly, you have less, or in some cases no, control over exact hardware configurations. Now that we know what HPC is and does, what does it look like? There are many possible configurations, usually depending on application requirements, but what is shown here is a simple HPC stack that can be used for the vast majority of situations. At the bottom, you have your hardware provisioner. This is what takes your HPC cluster and delegates resources to your application. Amazon AWS, Microsoft Azure, or VMware vSphere are a few of these technologies. Next is your application deployment orchestrator. This is what is in charge of managing your applications and providing networking between them. Kubernetes, AWS Fargate, and Docker Swarm are a few of the technologies within this section. Within your application orchestrator lives your application runtime. This could be containerization platforms like Docker or Containerd, or VMs running Windows or Linux distributions. In addition to your application runtime, you need a workload manager to support your application. This can take the form of an AMQP message broker like RabbitMQ or IBM MQ, or a data streaming manager like Apache Kafka. This is what maintains your workload while it's being processed and connects your client application to the HPC backend, splitting your workload amongst your workers and returning results. Finally, on top sits your application, built using VehicleSim, MATLAB, C code, or whatever your organization's product requires. As an example of an HPC application, look at this. Here we have a client application, let's say a DOE desktop application, used by an engineer in your organization. The engineer creates a permutation of CarSim simulations and sends them to the HPC cluster to be performed in parallel. The HPC cluster is local, on-site, and is provisioned by VMware vSphere, running a Kubernetes instance managed by VMware Tanzu. The engineer's workload from their desktop client application is sent to a RabbitMQ message broker. RabbitMQ takes the tasks within the workload and begins distributing them to the workers within the Kubernetes cluster. The workers are comprised of a Docker container running CarSim alongside some wrapper application to communicate with the message broker. Upon completion of a unit of work, the worker notifies RabbitMQ of its status and requests more tasks from the submitted workload, if any still remain. Meanwhile, the engineer watches on their client application as the results stream in. Now that we understand a bit more what an HPC application looks like, how well does this work with the VehicleSim family of products? The standard license included with a desktop version of a VehicleSim product is not optimized to run in an HPC environment. The rapid pace of executions in parallel require a different licensing model to ensure high throughput. Mechanical Simulation Corporation offers a special HPC licensing option, which can be purchased specifically for this purpose. As for designing an application to run in your HPC cluster, Mechanical Simulation has available our VS SDK, which provides a series of APIs and example projects for use in integrating with your product or creating wrapper applications to meet your organization's needs. Mechanical Simulation has experience with HPC deployments of VehicleSim as we use it internally for our own product testing. Our HPC cluster uses 400 workers to perform checks of our shipping example simulations across all our products and supported platforms, completing thousands of simulations in only a few minutes. We have additionally done work to perform 1 million runs in under an hour using our on-site HPC cluster, ensuring that our licensing server and solver are capable of meeting the demands that your organization may require. I'll now show a short demo of an example HPC application running CarSim to perform a DOE permutated batch of simulations, pruning for unacceptable results. The HPC environment will be mechanical simulations on-site HPC cluster running Kubernetes. The application will be CarSim within a Docker container communicating with an AMQP message broker. We have generated 10 copies of this application in our cluster, requiring 10 HPC licenses, making us capable of running 10 simultaneous simulations. The entirety of the application is written using the VS API and the VS Output API found within the mechanical simulation VS SDK. The workload consists of a base run, permuted across a pair of variables. The base run is the CarSim Quick Start Guide, a C-class hatchback performing a double lane change at 120 kilometers an hour with a half-second driver path preview, meaning that the driver is looking a half-second ahead of the vehicle when determining when to turn the steering wheel. Our DOE is as follows. We generate a batch of runs of that base run, but modulate the target speed from 60 kilometers an hour to 140 kilometers an hour, instead of the static base speed of 120 kilometers an hour. We will also modulate the driver path preview between 0 and 1 second. We will submit all permutations of these parameters on the base run, resulting in 459 submitted simulations to the HPC cluster. In addition, we will reject any results from these simulations that have an average lateral path deviation of the vehicle to the target path greater than the base run. In the base run, the average lateral path offset is 0.22 meters. So, any simulation where the average lateral path offset exceeds 0.22 meters, we will mark as rejected or failed. On a single desktop, we would expect this number of runs to take around 7 minutes, but with our 10-worker HPC cluster, we expect these 459 runs to finish in around 20 seconds. This is a simple demo application I wrote to visualize the results of the workload. Once I send the workload off-screen to the HPC cluster, we will immediately begin to see results stream in from the workers. Successful runs, those being with an average lateral vehicle offset being equal to or less than that of the base run, will appear in green, while those that exceed it will be colored red. As stated before, we should expect the 459 runs to complete in about 20 seconds. And as we can see, results are slowly coming in from our HPC cluster, and we are seeing some coded in green and some in red, denoting whether or not they succeeded or were rejected. The runs are complete, and we can see which have succeeded and which have failed in mass. As we would expect, slower speed simulations do not need as much driver preview as higher speed ones, and eventually we get to a speed where no amount of driver preview can stop us from exceeding our path offset limit. This visualization application is obviously quite simple, but could be made more complex through additional functionality, as is also the case with the HPC application. Increasing the number of variables that we permute across in our DOE and increasing the number of workers in our HPC cluster can drastically increase the number of total simulations and also drastically cut the time required to complete them. Thank you for watching this video on high performance computing for automotive simulation with VehicleSim.